Okay, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Crystal Fraser. I'm a PhD candidate at the University of Alberta. I also grew up in Inuvik and used to live in Yellowknife. I now live in Edmonton, so it's always fun to come back home. I'm also the mom of the conference baby, Quinn. So if you've heard something squawking that sounds like a cat, sorry about that. So I'm really excited for all of our speakers this afternoon. This conference panel is going to be an hour. And how we've organized the time is each individual or each group is going to have about 8 minutes. And they are going to explain their projects, what's exciting about it, what we need to know, and then we're going to move on to the next one. And then from my understanding, that is going to fill the first hour. And then we're going to have 20 minutes for some conversations and some questions. So if you can save your excitement until the final 20 minutes, that would be appreciated. So I have a few individuals to introduce here. I'm going to make it brief. So we have Mandy McDonald, who is right in the middle. I'm starting in the middle instead of left to right. Sorry about that. Shannon Crawley. Kyla Kakfui-Scott, Candace Parsons. We have Christian right here, who I'm sure everyone has met at some point. And we also have Greg at the end, who you were all introduced to earlier this morning. And who did I miss? I missed Tammy. There's Tammy right in the middle. Okay, so we can get started. I think that... And Tammy and Candace, we're going to start us off with a PowerPoint.
Good afternoon, everybody. Just to give you a little bit of a background on myself, my name is Tammy Rogers. I'm a Gwich'in participant. I'm originally from Inuvik. I've spent a little bit of time working for the government of the Northwest Territories, the Inuvialuit Regional Corporation, as well as the Gwich'in Tribal Council. I'm currently a GNWT employee, but I am on loan to the GTC under a secondment. So one of the projects that we're doing at Tribal Council is a project that I started working on at the GNWT when I worked with Human Resources. And it's a project that was brought to the Government of the Northwest Territories by the Tribal Council and answering a couple questions that we first had. The first question we asked ourselves are we ready for self-government? And I think the question that we, or the answer was, really? Probably not. We need to spend a little bit more time in developing our capacity. So then we worked with the GNWT, and a memorandum of intent on capacity building was signed between the GNWT and the GTC in Yellowknife on December 11th. That was the start of a lot of work. We spent a lot of time from the GNWT and the GTC on designing the program. When that memorandum was signed, there was commitments that were made to establish a working group and develop a terms of reference for the project prior to March 31st, 2014. At that time, we had spent, again, a lot of time designing the program, and we looked at exploring options to have the Government of Canada join us on this project. It was a way for us to address a process for exchange and development of staff and a way for us to design the program. We then got commitment from the Government of Canada and the Honourable Bernard Valcourt, Minister of Aboriginal Affairs at the time, signed a Memorandum of Understanding with the GTC on February 23rd, 2015. We then met with Premier McLeod of the GNWT and had a similar document signed committing both the Government of Canada, and the Government of the Northwest Territories to this project. Candace is going to tell you a bit about the project.
So what is the internship project? The Gwich'in Internship Pilot Project is a coordinated effort by the Gwich'in Tribal Council, the Government of Canada, and the Government of the Northwest Territories to enhance the skills of Gwich'in participants through on-the-job training in each different government. And the goal for the project is to increase the participation of Gwich'in participants in the territorial and federal government workforce, also to build stronger ties between the treaty partners and governments, and to implement the Gwich'in Comprehensive Land Claim Agreement, and to build the capacity of the 9 participants who would be going through the internship with the GTC. So each party is committed to providing developmental opportunities for all 9 Gwich'in participants within their government institution. The Gwich'in Internship Pilot Project will allow Gwich'in participants to gain valuable work experience within the federal government, the territorial government, and the local Aboriginal government. Participants will be provided with capacity-building opportunities, so each participant has a learning and development program, and they're assigned a mentor as well. Practical work experience and a greater understanding of the public service and preparation for future opportunities within the GTC. And the placements will be enhanced with formal and informal learning, as well as mentoring opportunities. So how can this program help communities, and why should communities consider this option? So this opportunity in the program increases the participation of the Gwich'in in the NWT workforce, including local communities. It builds stronger ties between the treaty partners, governments, and local communities, and also builds capacity within the Gwich'in participants, the knowledge, skills, and abilities of the participants, and they'll be able to take those skills with them throughout their career.
There are other objectives that are included in this project that are very beneficial, I guess, for the Gwich'in. It's a way of us to implement the land claim agreement. It's a way to increase the representation of Gwich'in in the federal and territorial civil service, as well as bring Gwich'in back to the NWT, which ties into the GNWT recruitment strategy to increase the NWT population. Our goal through this project is to see that we have a lot of people out there that are, a lot of Gwich'in participants. 54% of our membership actually live outside of the GSA, and we're like everybody else trying to get our educated people back home to come and work, and so we're hoping that this project is one way of doing that. The funding for this project it's a user pay model. So what that means is that when the interns work for the GTC pays their salary. When they work for the Government of Canada, the Government of Canada will pay their salary, and the same for the Government of the Northwest Territories. The governments have committed to use existing resources, so they haven't identified additional funding for this, but most governments are going to use vacant positions to provide us opportunities for our interns. The total project costs approximately $3 million, and that's over a 5-year period. So who can apply to the program? Gwich'in participants who have the following education experience can apply. What we found was we needed to have people that had education, a combination of education and experience to build upon in these different opportunities. So the minimum requirement is they must have a minimum of a diploma. 2 years of post-secondary education, and a minimum of 2 years work experience in the area that they're interested in. And they must be willing to relocate to various placements across the north. We currently have three interns that are working at the GTC, and of the three, they're all located in Inuvik, and I think next year we have two that are going to be relocating to Yellowknife, and I think we have one that's probably going to be relocating to Whitehorse. So it's a great, great program, and one of our interns is in the room, Bridget. It's your turn now. Sorry, Candace.
That's okay.
No problem.
So how can conference goers and their agencies leverage these opportunities? So one of the key factors is to ensure that you have your internal resources to fund the interns while they're at your organization. connect with the GNWT, so the Department of Human Resources, and the federal government, Indigenous and Northern Affairs of Canada. And you also need to put a structure in place. So there's a project coordinator that is dedicated to this project that is held within the Gwich'in Tribal Council, and also a joint working group, and that's the three different governments all have participants on the working group. And we meet weekly throughout the startup of the recruitment process. And we also have developed a work plan and schedule. So the current status, where we are to date, we have three interns within the Gwich'in Tribal Council who will be going over to the Government of Canada on September 1st of this year. And we also started the recruitment process for the next three interns. The advertisement went out this past Monday, and it'll close at the end of the month. And we're continually working on the developmental plans and recruiting mentors for the interns so they have them for the duration of the program. So, like I said, we are in the middle of advertising for the next round of interns. And hopefully by the middle of April to the beginning of May, we should have the next three in place for a startup in September. And we are in the process of recruiting the mentors as well.
Okay, thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Tammy and Candace, for sharing that information with us. It really seems like an exciting project that is really going to highlight how organizations can craft a strategy, have some really good goals, and then move forward with implementation. So I think next we'll have our next team present, which is going to be Shannon and Christian from IPAC.
Thank you very much. Really, I want to turn this over to Shannon Crawley. She's got some really exciting stuff to share with you. But before I turn that over to her, I did want to frame this offering a bit in the context of other efforts that IPAC NWT has been making to provide some humble offerings with respect to capacity building. A number of them are interrelated efforts we've been doing this year. Our business plan goal this year was inclusion. And by that, what we really wanted to accomplish was we really wanted to make sure that the Northwest Territories Regional Group of IPAC was not simply the Yellowknife Regional Group of IPAC or not simply the public servant Regional Group of IPAC. We really wanted IPAC and the offerings and programs that we've been keenly developing to be of service to everyone throughout the NWT. So we've done a number of things to accomplish this. And we've had a lot of help along the way. One of the things that we have done is the Aboriginal Government Officials Pilot Study, which Penny had mentioned in her address. So I won't tell you much more about that. That's something we're very excited about, but that's one such example. Another thing that we've done too is, as Penny mentioned, was try to make all of our offerings and certainly our lunchtime events available online. So this way, folks throughout the territory and at any time can enjoy our offerings. So that's another thing. And now we have a very special thing, and that I'd like to turn over to Shannon so that she can give you some of the details.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Christian, for that introduction, and you are now excused to get back on your Twitter. So I'll just start off by asking everyone to excuse me. I'm getting over a cough. If I chug any more Robitussin, I'll probably fall off the stage. So if I lose my voice, that's why. And as Christian mentioned, I'm here to introduce to you IPAC NWT's mentorship program. And this is a newly minted framework that was just passed by our board of directors. So I'm just going to present you with a brief overview and welcome any questions that anyone has. So often when we think about mentorship, what comes to mind is a formalized relationship between an older, wiser individual who imparts wisdom on a younger protege protege, sorry, who we're going to be referring to in our framework as the associate. But more recent approaches to mentorship, and the one that we've adopted at our IPAC NWT framework, is a more informal relationship that stands to benefit both participants and build upon their mutual expertise and understanding. So rather than being passive recipients of knowledge, the new Republic administrators will be bringing fresh perspectives, more modern approaches, access to social media networks, and that kind of thing. And these will be shared with the mentor. So the program that we've developed has three core objectives, and these are to foster professional knowledge exchange, to develop leadership skills and strengths, and to build and diversify professional experience. And the intention of the program is, of course, to build skills and understanding, but the primary method of achieving this objective will be through collaboration and through increased understanding from both participants. We've developed the program with a lot of consideration in the context of the North, with the goal of fostering intergovernmental understanding and the intention that it will transcend four orders of government, that being federal, territorial, Aboriginal, and community. And we'd also encourage the participation of non-government organizations with affiliations or an interest in the public sector. So in short, any IPAC member has access to this program. And while the focus of the program is on skills development, we do not want to limit the relationship to within an individual department or area. So we really actively encourage a match based on skills and career trajectory rather than looking at your manager and expecting to be mentored into that role. And we've had a lot of positive feedback about the success of mentorship programs that expand in between departments or even levels of government. So we've taken that into consideration as well. Another critical element of the matching process is finding a very good fit between the personalities of both participants. So in the framework, we've laid out some of our preferred characteristics for both parties, which include, for example, an associate who's enthusiastic, who's committed to ongoing improvement, and who's willing to adopt new ideas and approaches to work. And conversely, in a mentor, we seek a public administrator who's motivated, who's willing to share experience, techniques, and skills, and who has an interest in new and diverse ideas. Personality types, expectation, time commitment, and participant objectives are all factors that need consideration for an effective mentorship relationship. And this is especially true, we feel, in the context of the North, where you have factors like isolation and sometimes a limited separation between personal and professional spheres. So we were asked how these programs can help communities, and I'm sure there are many ways that a mentorship program can contribute to community capacity building. And what we're trying to do is provide a mentorship program that's open to all levels of administration so participants can build skills in a variety of roles. So for example, enabling a local communications or community engagement officer to connect with a more seasoned professional in a different community or in a different level of government, but who has experience applicable to the associate's role. And the associate can then build those skills in his or her own capacity. And a relationship of this nature would provide community-level insight and help public administrators at all levels understand challenges and opportunities associated with governance and administration at the community level. So it's our further goal that strengthening relationships and understanding across the levels of government will benefit communities simply by creating access to information. Having a source for insight, for resources, for contacts, connections, networking, etc., can all improve how administrative functions at different levels and policy at one level takes shape at another level. And so conference goers and their agencies can leverage these opportunities simply by becoming involved in the program. We actively invite input and participation from all sides and encourage organizations to make these programs accessible to their employees. So anyone interested in participating is welcome to contact me or any of my fellow IPAC board members. And I'm very happy to work with you on that. And we're also very eager to meet and discuss any other mentorship initiatives in the territory so that we can maximize our collective successful outcomes through collaboration. And the last thing I'll mention is why communities should consider these options. And I think I've covered a lot of the value of mentorship for public administrators and communities. But I'd like to reiterate the opportunity here to build understanding of community-level realities in other areas of government administration. Community-based administrators can speak to the gaps in policy implementation or program delivery that may not be obvious to all parties. For example, It's not always possible for communities to produce high volumes of written communications like flyers and handouts to get communication around. It's not always possible to refer community members to the internet, to a website. And it's not possible to assume that an email blast will reach more than a handful of individuals in a given area. There's accessibility considerations, language considerations, and capacity issues that exist in our communities that can be overlooked at other levels and areas of government. So we think that building mentorship relationships can really speak to that gap. And with that, I will stop rambling and pass along the mic.
Thanks so much for that. I think that talk really highlighted how large organizations need to think inclusively about how to reach various areas in the North, and often how community themselves can be overlooked when making programs like these, that you have to consider the various kinds of challenges that you'll be working with, whether it's in technology through email or various kinds of individuals that can really come from all levels. So thank you. I think at this point, I'll probably pass this on to Greg, and he can share his insights with us.
Howdy again. So what I want to chat a little bit is about some of the programs we got going at the Johnson Shoyama Graduate School of Public Policy that might be of interest to folks here. Kathy, you want to stand up for half a sec? Good evening, folks. So Kathy's the executive director for both campuses in Regina and Saskatoon. So when I do make all the mistakes and you want to get the real answer, talk to Kathy after. She's kind of sick, so after you shake your hand, use Purell and scrub your hands. But I've got some with me if you don't have any with you. So there's three programs here we want to talk about. And so I don't get shot by Kathy here, make sure I'm going to start with the Master's in Health Administration. And this one is really neat because it's an all-online master's program. So in that sense, trying to overcome some of the geographical barriers, and it's really great for folks in mid-career options. And the program currently have admitted students from every single province and territory in Canada, including here in the NWT. So, please welcome back again. And JSGS has internships for MPA students, and I think I won't go into detail about the value. I think that was covered incredibly well already, the values of internships with whether municipal, provincial, federal government, First Nations. Again, working with a mentor is so critically important, including with northern government organizations. And that's so critical, bringing interns north and having northerners can do internships in the north. So those are a couple of things that we have through the Masters of Public Administration program. And, of course, the all online Masters of Health Administration. And, of course, that's critically important in any jurisdiction in Canada. And then there's two other programs I wanted to chat about, and we've had students from the territories. I currently actually am supervising a student from Yellowknife in one of our programs. So we have a Master's in Northern Governance and Development, and it's not a Master's of Arts in. It's a Master's of Northern Governance and Development. And how that critter came about, when we set up the International Center for Northern Governance and Development, and we met with First Nations, Métis, both Prince Albert Grand Council, Meadow Lake Tribal Council, industry, local government, New North in Saskatchewan. And we sat down and said, if you were to hire somebody, we got a blank piece of paper, forget what kind of courses we've got at the university, what would be the most important? And they went through issues, northern governance, because the jurisdictional chaos we often encounter with the multi-level governance, on resource economics, strategic planning, a writing course, you know, writing briefing notes and those kind of things you're talking about, like flyers and stuff, that are critically important. And we also built in an internship, a research internship for students. And I can't overemphasize, I totally agree with my colleagues up here, how critically important and valuable those are. But the other component we added to our Master's in Northern Governance and Development is a study abroad, required study abroad. Now, when we started our Master's, we actually thought, and even when we met with band councils and so on, folks thought we'd be graduates, say, out of a bachelor's education or whatever program we've got going, which typically is a common program in our north. And it turned out we were dead wrong. And one of the lessons we learned, probably 70% of our students, if not more, are actually working professionals. So they're working either for band governments, local governments, working in industry or whatever, and have families. So the idea to uproot and go south is simply not a reality. So our program is video conferencing, a bit online, and bringing students together for short courses. And the face-to-face component is critically important. And the study abroad, instead of going for 4 months, which is totally unrealistic, we have a field school going, actually in Northern Norway, next week on March 11th there. And they go over for nine days and see for themselves. And it's back-to-back meetings with government folks, Sami, Parliament, industry, etc. Because one of the things when you go to a place like Northern Norway, there's a high level. You know, take the financial crisis in 2008. The unemployment in Northern Norway tripled. It went from 1% unemployment to 3% unemployment. So that's the kind of catastrophe we're going to try and generate in Northern Saskatchewan. But it's even the worst hit Indigenous communities in Northern Norway have only 8% unemployment. So they're doing some things right. And in Canada, a lot of times folks think if you're in the north, that means you have poor services, everything else. It doesn't have to be that way. And countries like Norway show you can do things differently in a different way. It's getting beyond the Pleasantville syndrome, I call it. You've seen the movie Pleasantville with Tobey Maguire, where the movie, everything's black and white, and he tells people there's colors and there's a road beyond Pleasantville, and no one believes him until by the end of the movie, of course. Well, that's the value of the international component. It's trying to get beyond Pleasantville. The other one that we started up is a joint degree. It's called Masters of Governance and Entrepreneurship in Indigenous and Northern Areas. And so it's genie. So it sounds like genie in a bottle. But in Norwegian, it sounds cool because it means genius. And that's where you have Sami students who are the Indigenous peoples of Northern Norway and other Northerners and Northerners from, like I said, one of our students is actually here from Yellowknife and from Northern Saskatchewan. And that's a true joint degree. It's the first joint degree between Canada and Norway. And again, we've added on courses into that as well, like a consultation negotiation. So there's a number of us are actually involved, including someone like Tom Malloy, who actually was the chief negotiator for Nunavut and Niska. He's going to be teaching one of our courses on negotiations. So we've got a few things like that going. The other thing that's built in is Indigenous perspectives. And that's really important, as Chief Bellegarde has mentioned previously, in terms of the treaty relationship. And Benita Beattie teaches that course. And what's wickedly cool about that one is you've got Dene students, Cree students, and then you have Sami students and so on, looking at how these different, what are the terms that are used for sustainable way of life and so on, that get worked into everyday workings, and how does that factor in when you're actually running governments in the north. So welcome aboard. Yeah, we'd love to have students. And when you want to get the real information, talk to Kathy. Thank you.
Thanks so much for that, Greg. I think information about higher education is immensely important for our younger people in the communities. I can only speak from my own experience, but having went to university after high school, I was 23 years old, and I really had no clue about how any of this stuff worked. I'm a historian, but that totally happened by accident. I just found something I loved and just kind of went with it. So thank you. Hopefully all of you have absorbed that information and can then relay that to interested individuals. Okay, so now I'm going to hand the mic off to Mandy.
Tansay Mandy McDonald Natsikasin. My name is Mandy McDonald. I'm originally from Churchill, Manitoba. I am the program manager at Tichinta Bush University Center for Research and Learning. I've been with the organization for about 3 years. I went away to university after high school. I did my BA in Political Science and Indigenous Studies, and I did my Master's in Indigenous Governance at UVic as well. So Tichinta is a really, really awesome program, and I will tell you everything about it right now, and then I will get to the questions that were posed to the panel. But we do land-based university-accredited courses, and we do 12-week semesters a year, and then we do 1 to 3 one-week short courses throughout the year as well. So for the 12-week semesters, we do 7 to 8 weeks on the land, on Blatchford Lake. The first 3 weeks were in camps, canvas tents with wood stoves. Our cohort sizes are 10 to 12 students. So the first 3 weeks were on the land. Students learned to set tents, haul water, haul wood, find wood, chop wood, all these things, camp cook. And we do 5 university-accredited courses per semester. And the courses are accredited through the Faculty of Native Studies at the University of Alberta and the University of British Columbia and McGill University. Our next program starts April 10th. And the courses that we are doing are called Indigenous Self-Determination in Theory and Practice, which looks at the history of colonization in Canada, analyzes a lot of Canadian legislation and policies like the Indian Act, residential schools, 60 Scoop, and things like that. We're doing the Sustainable Communities course, which looks at climate change in the North, petrocapitalism, climate justice, renewable energy. And in that course as well, we install solar panels at the lodge. We've installed wind turbines. Blatchford Lake Lodge is an eco lodge, and we learn about how all of the sustainability systems work, like the Clevis, which is a human waste composting facility, and they have an organic garden and all these things. We do subsistence harvesting. We hunt. We set fish nets. We make dry meat. We learn to make dry fish and prepare traditional foods. We do moose hide tanning, paddling, learn about the area. All the courses are co-instructed with regional elders and Indigenous university professors, northern technical experts, and leaders. We're also doing a course called Community Health Promotion, which looks at the social and environmental determinants of health in Indigenous communities. So this semester we'll be looking at the Truth and Reconciliation Commission report and looking at the intergenerational impacts of colonization and things like that, but also it's a very empowering program. It's not all, you know, colonization sucks, but we look a lot and engage in a lot of really positive actions and cultural revitalization. There's a lot of academic literature out there that points to cultural and language revitalization as the main source of Indigenous empowerment, health promotion, and well-being. So it's really a leadership program and a health program, and it's accredited by universities. So students can come to us and do a semester or 2 semesters with us. We are working towards providing a full degree, but right now we have a roster of 8 courses that we provide. But students can opt to continue post-secondary studies. It's very easy to kind of get into the probationary stream at the University of Alberta, so there's no prerequisites to apply to Tichinta, and typically a lot of students in the North have had a pretty negative experience in public education, and a lot of us didn't do that well, but they come to Tichinta because there's a ton of support on site. We have academic support, elders on site with us teaching the courses, and so our students are typically very successful. And when some of them may not have had any interest in going to post-secondary before, many of them do access that probationary stream and are doing very well in institutions down south. Many of our alumni have gone on to take on important leadership positions in their communities. I see one of our alumni, Mason, here. Hi, Mason. So the other courses that we're doing in the spring, Communicating Denide, which is a communications-based course. So that one is instructed by Richard Van Camp. And in the past, we've had people come and do media communications, how to write an op-ed. We had a podcasting workshop as a part of a previous semester where Ryan McMahon came and facilitated storytelling and digital storytelling workshops. And we have amazing podcasts from our students on our website that anyone can listen to. They're really, really good. And we also have amazing kids programming. So when Dachinta was sort of in the developmental stages and planning stages, some of the research that went into that found that one of the biggest barriers to women in the North accessing post-secondary education was childcare. So we have a program on site called Kids U. So it's childcare for children 3 and under, but then kid-led or child-led learning for K to 12. So that basically means that the children decide with the Kids U facilitator and the elders on site what they want to learn. And a lot of times that's paddling. So they'll learn to paddle, canoes, kayaks. They'll make traditional medicines or learn how to make bug repellent out of ingredients from the bush. Last time they wanted to learn how to tan squirrel hides, so they tanned little squirrel hides. And so it's a really empowering and awesome program for kids as well, and there's no additional cost for that. So we absorb the cost to just make the program more accessible. But there's also support for children who need to stay caught up with their schoolwork from back home. So if their parents bring their schoolwork with them on site, we have support staff available who will sit with the kids and get that done as well. In terms of capacity building, I think it's an amazing capacity building program. I can speak from personal experience, but I won't get into that. But I'm a Dachinta alumni as well. I took the program when I was doing my undergraduate degree, and I took it to supplement that degree because I felt like a lot of the content in my third year was not particularly relevant to what I wanted to learn. And I actually ended up job shadowing the founding program manager, who's Kyla, after that. And then years later, after I did my master's, I became the program manager, and feel like it's a really important opportunity to facilitate for people in the North who want to develop leadership skills, who are maybe interested in some post-secondary but don't want to move all the way down south or aren't really sure what they want to do. And in terms of leveraging opportunities, I feel like as an organization, we have a proven track record of success. Our students are doing amazing, but we don't have core funding. So if there is any funding available from any of your departments that you want to invest in amazing programming, that's something we could talk about for sure. And what's the last question? Oh, and why is it important for communities? Well, we have been offering programs for 6 years, mostly at Blatchford Lake Lodge on Chief Dry Geese territory in the Quechua region of Denide. Last year in August, we did our first pilot in another area. We started at Dachinla Lodge and shared Kaska Dene Satu Dene territory. It was a 3-week long pilot where we started at Dachinla Lodge and hiked 40 miles up the Canole Heritage Trail to Caribou Pass. And that partnership was initiated by the Ross River Dene Council. And so we have a number of other interested regions and communities who would like to do Dachinta programming in their areas. It takes quite a lot of work to plan a pilot, but that's something that is a really important part of our long-term strategic plan. So if there are people from the communities or different organizations who want to talk about providing programming like this in your area, that's something we're really, really interested in. and I'm happy to discuss more with anybody afterwards. I'll be around all day. Merci.
I'm going to keep Crystal from having to get up again. So I'm Kyla Cackfoy-Scott. I professionally work with the Department of Health and Social Services as senior advisor to the deputy minister, but I'm here today to talk about my work with Den and Owl, which is a relatively new organization in the NWT. Den and Owl is a collective group of people working together that came out of all of the Idle No More activities. And you know, after the second time that we shut everyone down from being able to go about their lunch hour business to have a round dance in the middle of Franklin Avenue, we started talking about, well, what are we going to do next? Because that's great to draw attention to that there are issues and we need to be doing something, but what is that and what is our role going to be in that and how are we going to take it on? So over the course of the period leading out of that, we sort of as a, by trial and error in a really organic iterative process, grew into a collective that's working to advance social and environmental justice for Northern peoples and to promote Indigenous leadership. So Den and Owl, as named, Owl is like the way of doing things. So we're setting out to do things in a Dene way or in a good way or in the people's way. And we are striving to foster emerging leaders, to strengthen relationships, and to create long-term positive change in the North, believing that the solutions to problems that we see in communities are rooted in the teachings of our ancestors. And so we're emphasizing and encouraging the revitalization of culture and our connection to the land and carrying out our work in a way that is true to that. A little bit on the structure of the organization, because that's part of how everything else comes to be. We have consciously established ourselves not as a hierarchical structure. So in starting out, and we wanted to start doing things in an organized manner and being able to get some funding for it and run some programs. And normally you would do that by establishing a society or a nonprofit corporation or any of those, and you'd have your board of directors and your person who's in charge. And we felt really strongly that we had a group of people around the table who had all had equal contribution to setting the vision for what we were trying to do, and we needed to continue to honor that. So we have plugged in to Tides Canada Initiatives, which is a shared charitable platform. Basically, for an administrative fee, they take care of all of our back-end administration, so we don't have to do any of our own bookkeeping or file our year-end returns or any of that stuff that eats up a whole lot of energy for any new organization that doesn't have a whole lot of staff capacity. I think we are, it's safe to say, we were the first Northern project to join the Tides platform, and we are the only one, I think, in the country that insists on not having a hierarchy. So they really have struggled with, but who's the one person, who's the boss? And we say, no one, you have to talk to all of us. We did, however, hire in the last year, and I will circle back around to this, our first full-time staff person, and we now have a full-time program director as well as some part-time communication support and research assistants. If anyone, some of you may have heard of us, we have sort of a mixed bag of programs, and that has come out of what we've set out to do. The vision for Dene and Owl is land, language, culture forever. And we've really tried to organize ourselves to be not a group that talks about things so much as a group that does. And so the approach being, if you feel strongly enough about an issue that you have something to say about it, then you probably feel strongly enough about that issue that you have a thought about a solution and the energy to put into being a part of that solution. We've opened it up to any of our members and really to anyone who's approached us. It's all been fairly organic to bring forward different project ideas, things where they see a need in their community or a gap that is just something that's not being provided or isn't an easy fit with any other organization. And we figure out what we can do to support that and make it happen. The gap is a really important thing because there are lots of great organizations doing a ton of work, and we're not seeking to replace any of those, but there were lots of examples that each of us could bring to the table about an idea that we had that was just, it didn't quite fit with the Shenta, it didn't quite fit with the Dene Nation, it didn't quite fit with our home regions, it didn't have a place, it was a little homeless thing with an individual who wanted to make it happen and didn't have any way to go about that. So we've really established ourselves as a platform for innovation and excellence, and what that looks like depends entirely on the project lead and their idea. Some of the stuff that we've run in the last couple of years include cultural revitalization activities. So we have a whole series doing moose hide tanning projects in different regions and caribou hide tanning in different regions of the territory. And that was building on work that some of our founding members were doing anyway. One of the barriers they ran into really quickly was a lack of tools. So there's lots of people from a younger generation who didn't grow up learning those skills from their mothers and from their grandmothers, and they want to be able to learn them, but it's not necessarily easily accessible in the community, or you don't know the right person to go to. And then even if you can find someone who's willing to teach you, you can't just go to the store and buy your moose hide tanning tools. Someone has to make them for you or hand them down. And increasingly, knowing how to make those tools is also sort of a lost art. So we organized a tool-making workshop because that seemed like a good way to address that barrier. We have, what else have we done? Most substantially, I think, a year ago, November, organized the Indigenous Circumpolar Women's Gathering, which brought together 100 women from across the circumpolar world. And that one had open parameters on some fronts. We didn't define what woman meant. If you felt that applied to you, you could come. And we didn't define what Indigenous meant. If you felt that applied to you, you could come. Everyone had to apply, including our own membership. It was not a given that if you wanted to sign up, you were going to get to go to the gathering. But we did put an express limitation on not having any elected leaders in that room. And that's one of the things that we've tried to focus on through a lot of our work, building really respectful relationships with the people who are leading our communities and leading our organizations. Those are really important networks and connections. But those are all the people that get to come to rooms like this all the time and to sit around tables and have these conversations. And if you go into a community, everyone knows who the people are who are doing all the work to organize all the events and to pull everyone together, and anytime that there needs to be a community gathering or whatever. But those people aren't necessarily connected to each other across communities. And so there's a lot of, I have an idea and I'll start everything from scratch. When if the networks existed, it would be so much simpler to just call over to the next town or the next region or the next territory even maybe and say, here's what I'm doing, what are your thoughts, or be able to bounce things off of people. So that's been a big part of it. The Women's Gathering is intended to be part of an ongoing series, but network building one. So the next one is intended to be hosted by Nunavut, and we'll support that however they would like us to. And then one of our big undertakings right now is an Indigenous leadership development program, which we piloted this fall with invited participants from the Nunavut equivalent group called Kanak, from the Yukon equivalent group called Our Voices, from Rematriate with some Dashinta alumni, and with alumni from the Jane Glasgow Northern Fellowship Program, to put together a customizable program that communities can use for different age and experience groups, to give people, you know, a quick hit 2 to 3 days of what are the things that you really need to be able to make a meaningful leadership impact in your community, and to give people the facilitation experience that they need to be able to lead those. So those are some of the things that we are doing. In terms of how that applies to, I'm going to address the conference and communities as a whole, because I'm looking at all of you and it seems to me like the conference is representing communities pretty well. One of the things that we don't have a program to address yet, but we've identified as an issue, is representation, particularly in Yellowknife, of the Indigenous population here, which is not the Yellowknife's Dene population, but comes from all regions of the territory. And that is represented within our founding members, who none of whom are from this place. We're from every other region in the territory. The only thing that we've done explicitly about that so far was in the territorial election to host an Indigenous Issues election forum for Yellowknife candidates. thinking that it's important for whether or not the elected representatives are Indigenous or not, that they clearly have a focus on how they're representing that 50% of their electorate. That's something that I think we don't have the solutions to, but I'm sure that communities want to make sure that their people in Yellowknife are well represented, and that people who are working in Yellowknife want to make sure that they're serving the residents here. So that's something that has a lot of opportunity for great partnership and innovation. And for anyone who's in a community who has a project that they want to get off the ground and they don't quite know how to go about doing that, we do have full-time staff. We have some great back-end expertise available and a good diverse team of people. So we would love to chat with all of you. We're working on getting out into communities more this year. That's a big focus of what we're trying to do to expand the organization. So if we don't see you here, we'll see you at home probably within the next couple of months.
Great, thanks. Sorry, it's a little loud. Thanks so much to Mandy and Kyla. I saw a number of areas that overlapped in your talks that are actually really exciting for the North, and one of them is using old ideas, Indigenous ideas, our ideas, to lead us into the future, whether you're in education or you're in politics, the importance of local knowledge. And Mandy, I appreciated when you were explaining maybe some of the innovative ideas that could bring in youth, like podcasts, like special accommodations for new families. I think that's really important. And Kyla, I appreciated your insights about how to kind of kick off a new organization that is really trying to penetrate all of the old boundaries of hierarchy, and figure out that there is a new way of undertaking ideas and executing those ideas. So thank you both very much for that. When we organized this panel, or when I was brought into this panel, some of the key questions that we kind of asked everyone to think about was, how can these programs help communities? How can conference goers or you guys, but also us up here, how can we use these opportunities, whether that means identifying that it's a good idea and then manipulating it for our own use, or harnessing it in a new way, and why it is that as representatives of our communities, as interested people, as elected individuals, why is it that communities should be at the center of all of these ideas? So I encourage you to think about those questions. We are about 5 minutes ahead of schedule, so I just really want to thank everyone for respecting the time barrier I set. I didn't have to give the stink eye once, so that's a success in itself. So I guess now it's my understanding that there's a Q&A period, so I think we'll just go ahead and launch right into that. I'm not sure if we I see a mic in the back there. Yeah, so we two. Okay, so we do have people who will come to you. So if I could ask you, if you do have a question, you know, it can be intimidating standing up in a room in front of everyone. I've totally been there, like, right now. So we're all friends, so any idea is welcome. So if you could stand up and introduce yourself and explain where you're from, that would be appreciated. And yeah, is there any initial questions? Does anyone want to kick us off? Oh, I have one in the corner back there. And maybe if you could address who your question is for, if you know.
We need the back.
backup mic.
Don't give it to me.
Yesterday we had an opportunity to have supper with the MP, Michael McLeod. And one of the big issues that he raised, which is a real concern to everybody, is that in Canada is the disappearance of Aboriginal languages in all of Canada. And if that trend continues, then we're faced with only maybe about two languages left in the next 10 years. So it is disturbing. And when we first started implementing language in the schools, it went back to 1983 when a report came out called Tradition and Change. And up to that point in time in 1983, all the Aboriginal organizations and First Nations people spoke very fluently in their language, even little ones in that era. So that has changed tremendously. And I'm just wondering if the Shinta or the Nao or have taken a look at that particular concern. And if you are looking at ways maybe to try to revitalize the language and culture, because it truly is a dying culture unless we do something about it. That's my question.
Well, I'll give a response for Dene Nawong. This is one that we've spent a lot of time talking about, and it's the same challenge for us probably as a little micro example as it is for anyone. We've got people from every region, and so if we were to set up a language course, which one would it be? And so we've kind of gotten stuck on that, but we did make for this year some small commitments because we felt that we needed to demonstrate our commitment through personal action. So some small things. If you see a media advisory or anything going out from us about any of our projects happening in the regions this year, they will include quotes in the languages from that region. And each one of us has committed that by the end of this year, we will be able to, in a format like this, introduce ourselves in our own language, and if we're called upon to do so, be able to offer a prayer. You will have noted that Mandy, who's part of Dene Nawong, introduced herself in her own language, and I did not. So obviously I'm not living up to my commitment yet, but it's only February, or March. Time is ticking, but I'm going to get to it. But that's, we're trying to, as I said, to live what it is that we're trying to do. So that's the first step, and hopefully that's the first step in many, and we're able to build on that and do bigger things in the future.
I will answer that as well. Thank you for the question. At the Chinta and the programs, language is a huge topic that we talk about a lot in terms of the value of traditional languages and the concepts within them that are not really transferable or translatable to English. But in terms of providing language programming, it's extremely, extremely difficult because we have tried in the past, but all of the local language instructors are stretched so thin already, it seems. Many of them also work as interpreters or translators and have jobs like that. And instructors at Chinta, we're a registered charity, and you don't make that much money. So it is something we have tried to implement in the past. But also with language learning, one of our instructors, Leanne Simpson, explained to us once that it takes two generations to lose a language and five or six to relearn it. So it's a huge process, and it does require significant resources. And, you know, a lot of what we talk about is the capacity to regenerate and wake up our languages is in our communities already, but the resources are not there in terms of funding, which, you know, and it's kind of unfortunate to always talk about funding, but people need to buy groceries, they need to pay rent and things like that. So I think that that is one of the big barriers. So I do think it's really important, but it's so difficult and it's such a huge challenge. And I don't have the answer, but thank you.
Good afternoon. Question for Kyla and Mandy, and then the I don't know who to direct the question to for the partnership, but some really impressive programming. And interested to take some of these learnings from the people of the north to the south, some great things. So, want to hear about some of the positive impacts and how are you measuring some of the positive developments at the community level through your work?
Well, if I can talk about lack of capacity for a minute, we spent a lot of time when we were first developing our programs talking about what comes first. Do we reach out and partner with communities, or do we run programs? And how do we know that the programs are going to be valuable to communities if we're not starting there? But also, communities are busy, and people are called upon all the time to talk about other people's priorities and what makes us different if we're just showing up from Yellowknife and saying, hey, we have a great idea, you're going to love it, and they'll be like, what have you ever done? You have nothing to back that claim up. So we started off trying to run a couple of programs so that we would have something to be able to demonstrate when we actually started doing that outreach. And the very first program that we ran was the Moosehide Tanning Program. And we had a couple of people who were invited from different regions because we had been involved with them before on Moosehide Tanning work, so they came for the tool making. And one of them was so excited about it that she posted on Facebook and was like, I'm going to this program organized by Den and Elmo, it's so amazing. And suddenly it was all over social media, and we were getting media requests, and everyone wanted to know who we were and what we were doing and how they could get involved and when the next program was going to be. And we were like, ah. No one knows, because we're all just doing this in our spare time. But that spurred a lot of interest, and that went through, I mean, that was true for then the hide tanning workshops and for the women's gathering and everything that we organized. I mean, we didn't have anyone working for us until August of last year, of 2015. And everything that we had done before that was people working off the sides of their desks and around the clock, and just because they felt committed to whatever project they had taken on. The Nina Larson, who's the founding member who organized the women's gathering, did that. She had a baby 10 days before that gathering happened, and she was sending us emails the night that he was born because it needed to happen and it needed to go really well. So I think there was a big discrepancy for a while in the perception of what the organization was and what it was capable of versus our capacity to actually deliver on that. So that's been challenging over the last year, I would say, because there is some interest and people want to be able to work with us on some projects or different ideas that they have, and we just haven't been able to deliver on that. So we're really, really excited about having the project director, because that's what she's there for, and it's something that we've been able to take on a little bit more. So we've done some work in the Gwich'in region. We've had some interaction with a group in Fort Simpson that's starting to work on things, and it's slowly building, but at a much more manageable pace now. And we've really tried to take the approach that it's not, we'll offer what we think is of value and trust that we're not, it's not a one-off opinion, that if it's valuable and needed by the people that we're working with, then that will translate to other communities and to other experiences. But really waiting to have other people approach us and say what it is that they need and want to do and how they think that we could be a part of that.
For us, how we try to measure the impact, we have a bunch of sort of our evaluation mechanisms built into the program. So we have intake interviews to assess each student's learning goals and objectives and experience levels in both land-based experience and academic schooling experience. And we have a midpoint sort of long-form oral interview to assess everything that's been going on in the program so far. Is it meeting your expectations? Are there things that we should be adapting to at this point for the next few weeks? And then we have an exit survey, and we also keep in touch with a lot of our alumni. So we have quite a large network of alumni right now. Something like 250 students have completed either a short professional development course or one of the semester programs. And our alumni are our biggest, most important resource because they are the ones who provide all the feedback on their program, and we take that feedback very seriously and use it to adjust or revise, or it informs the next program delivery. And then our alumni are involved in our strategic planning. So in the fall, we had a alumni gathering out at Blatchford Lake Lodge, where we invited alumni from each semester program to come and talk about how the experience impacted them, their learning goals and objectives, their career goals and objectives, and how they envisioned Dushinta for the next 50 years. And like I said before, a lot of our alumni went on to pursue further post-secondary education. They're doing really well. And a lot of them went on to take on really important leadership positions in their communities. And sometimes, in some cases, those positions are on chief and council, and sometimes they're doing amazing work with youth. And some of them are making jewelry out of traditional items. They've gotten more into subsistence harvesting, providing things for their community. And then where our alumni come from, those regions have come to us and want to partner on program delivery, collaboration, and things like that. So those are some of the ways that we measure the impact. And most of our evaluation is qualitative. So it's quite difficult to translate into quantitative terms, which is what is required of all our reporting requirements for all our grants. But in terms of what we do, that's how we measure the impact. And that's it.
Yeah, you know, I can add what we've, our programs are kind of new, and we've had them for a few years, but there's two big things. The network issue is huge, and that can't be overemphasized. When you think of Southern Canada, and you think of, say, former Prime Minister Brian Mulroney, he might be a conservative, and then you have Frank McKenna, who's a liberal, but they both went to St. Evex, they got their X-Men rings and so on, where people went to Upper Canada College. But they become corporate Canada, governing Canada. They have a network. When there's a problem, they pick up the phone and solve it. One of the things through these kind of programs, in our master's program, be among them, it was very deliberate to build a professional network of Northerners. That's the future leadership. And that network is critical. That network is information. It's a network is access to resources. It's huge, sharing what works here, what doesn't, and that is emerging, and that continues to go on, continue. So that was a very deliberate strategy. The other thing is around the capacity building, and so we can measure the network. That's what they're doing. But the other thing is capacity building. So it's capacity in terms of the individual who's getting education, of course. But one of the things we deliberately designed, and this was what the communities wanted, we could add a course-based master's program or a thesis-based master's program. They want a project-based in applied research. That's identified what are priorities that matter to communities. And so when it's capacity building within the community itself, not just the researcher who's from that community. So both are going on. So a couple of examples. One in LaRange, they were going to do a housing subdivision, but based on the traditional Southern kind of approach. When the student had come out of it, said, no, we can do this differently, and sat down and totally redid. They totally redid, and the government accepted it, and it went well. So we have a number where policy is actually what the students are going through the program or applying it in the north. That's impact right there. And the other, of course, another one is positions. And leadership positions in organizations rather than the southern north conveyor belt of folks where those are being occupied by graduates across these and building that capacity that stays on, and you have the institutional memory and everything that carries on across generations. So that's a third way of measuring.
I earlier introduced myself as an engineer, but now this question is with respect to community development. I have witnessed that Dene Naho conducted all candidates meeting for the last GNWT election. Am I right? That was well conducted. I witnessed that. So my question is, I think I understood correctly that you were talking about one of your objectives might be to see the elected members represent the constituents as well as constituents' interests. So if that is the case, the present Liberal government, the federal government, one of the platform was to make an electoral reform so that voters and voter counts are represented very well. So will you be interested, will you be taking part in that process if they have a consultation process or any kind of that nature? And how will you do that? So that is my question.
I think the intent of the forum, and I should say that I wasn't involved in the organizing of the forum at all, but the thought was that regardless of how anything is structured, regardless of how ridings are broken up or what our system is for putting people into office, whoever is there needs to be representing the people as a whole. And I think, I would say that in the territory, I think very often the divide ends up being characterized as smaller communities versus the regional centers. And that diminishes to some extent what the actual composition of the regional centers is. And for someone, I'm from the Satu region, there's a huge population of people from the Satu region in Yellowknife. There's over 300 of us. That's true for the Gwich'in. That's true for basically every single region. There's a huge population living in Yellowknife. And it it makes it difficult to be involved in what your regional governance looks like because you're not there. But it can also feel very, not just underrepresented here, but also like it's hard to find a place because it's not your territory, right? I mean, this is Yellowknife's Dene territory, and it's important to be really respectful of that. But there is nonetheless a substantial portion of the city that has a voice that's somewhat distinct, and that's not always one that's well articulated, I think, or well understood. That's an important part of it also, is if it can't be expressed as a collective experience, then it can't be understood by people who aren't coming from that experience. And so it's important not only to bring that up as part of the dialogue, but also to give that opportunity to our public representatives to have the opportunity to come to understand that better.
Hi there. My question is for Dijinta. All the skills that you described learning at the university or the Bush University, for those of us that know most of the skills or some of the skills or all the skills, where can we apply to get these credits?
Well, you can apply to the program and you would excel in those areas. And an important part of Dijinta programming, it's mentorship, peer-to-peer mentorship is a very important integrated part of the program. So many of our students come to us with excellent land-based skills, sewing or moose hide tanning, hunting, can set up a canvas tent really, really quick. And some people have zero land-based skills but have a little bit of academic experience. And how it ends up happening on site is that the people that are really skilled in one area end up supporting the students in that area for a big part of the program. And that is peer-to-peer mentorship on site. So if you wanted to apply to the program, you would be an excellent peer mentor in all those things. But you still have to write all the assignments and do the oral presentations and things like that, and then you'll get the credits. Yay.
Is it on? Hello, my name is Sabat, and I work with the Department of Aboriginal Affairs, specifically with the Intergovernmental Council. My question is for the Tammy. When you talked about the internship, I'm very interested in knowing. One of the things that I've been tasked with doing is compiling all kinds of information on funding sources for training and capacity development. The problem is you can invest all kinds of money into training somebody, but at the end, is there a job for them? Do you have money to be able to hire that individual, that well-trained individual? And one of the things I'm finding is no, you can get project dollars, maybe for short-term projects, but if you have an opportunity to get a government job that has all the benefits and means moving to Yellowknife or to a larger center, if you're somebody who is young, has children, a family, you are going to take that job rather than staying in your community. So when we're talking about capacity development in the community, I think those are some of the things that we need to take a look at, is what funding is available, what resources are available to provide those employment opportunities. Because capacity to me is not just about training, it's also about having a job at the end of the day. I'm very interested in knowing what your experience has been with regards to finding employment for people who have been trained at the end. Before I turn it over to you, I just want to make a comment, though. A lot of people know I've been extensively involved in languages. And it was something to think about when, you know, you go into, I go into a convenience store, and sometimes you have the Asian people that run the convenience store have their little children, and they're not speaking English. They're speaking the Aboriginal language. But you don't have a whole bunch of money thrown towards their programs. Why is it they're speaking their language and our children aren't? It's because they're speaking it at home. I think we're going to have to start changing our thinking in saying, well, we can't speak our language because we don't have the money. We have to change our thinking and start speaking it at home. I'm guilty of that. I didn't speak it to my child. He knows how to ask for money in Chippewa easily. But he doesn't know how to speak it, and that's my fault, and I have to accept the responsibility. So I think we need to think about that. We need to think, change our thinking is, well, we can't do it because we don't have the money. If foreigners, people who are coming into our communities are maintaining their language simply by speaking at home, surely we can start working on that. Okay, so we'll go back to my question and turn it over.
The way that the program was designed is that our anticipation was that we were going to have, at the end of the program, 9 very highly qualified individuals that could basically work anywhere. One of the challenges that we had in designing the program is we needed to have a commitment from each of the parties that was involved that they would not make job offers to these candidates midstream throughout the program, because we wanted them to benefit from the full program and not just, you know, maybe they just love working for us at GTC and didn't want to go on to their internship with the federal government or the territorial government. So we did make that commitment with all three parties, and in response to, you know, your concern about the funding, we expect that as a Gwich'in Nation in preparation for self-government, that we are going to have an awful lot of opportunities out there. We may not have those opportunities when these individuals complete the program, but we expect that they will be employed. We've got opportunities with each of these governments where they're going to learn valuable skills, and these skills are going to be transferable. I think anybody that has opportunity to work in an Aboriginal government as well as a public government, who wouldn't want to hire them? They're going to have great skills, and I don't think it's something that we're going to have concern about. We do have a lot of people in the communities who don't want to move to the larger centres. And we also, one of the projects that we're doing with Tribal Council right now is we have another capacity building initiative. I'm not sure, do I have time to talk on that? Okay, so we have a capacity building project right now where we're doing an assessment of our community capacity. So determining what do we have available to meet the needs for our communities. And so we're expecting that once we're going through this capacity assessment and determining, you know, what are our communities doing, what do they have in regards to human resource capacity, that at the end of this project, we're going to have a lot of people, or our interns, we're hoping, will actually, some of them are going to want to go home and work in their home communities, because we've already started to do those assessments.
Thank you. Kate, I think we have one final question here.
Inspired by many of these programs, I want to see them all kind of emulated and succeed. And I take the last point about the need for more resources to really make them thrive. But I wanted to ask a question about using existing resources, because the one kind of capacity building I haven't heard as much from on the panel is secondments from existing positions. So you spend a year with, for example, an Indigenous government if you're in the territorial government, or with the territorial government if you're in the federal government, or from one Indigenous community to another, to really get that lateral sense of skills and to have the experience if you're from a regional center of living in a different kind of community, or vice versa, without making a career-long commitment. So I've seen these programs really succeed in building that sense of what it's like to walk in someone else's shoes better than any other kind. And some of these internships are doing that. But again, the question is who hires them at the end, whereas a secondment already has a salary. So it's not new money, but it's using the existing money, many would say more effectively, to get that lateral sense of understanding. So just curious if you've experienced those, if there are those secondment programs, and if not, why not?
Thank you. That's a good question. I mentioned earlier that I am on a secondment. I currently, my home position is Superintendent of Human Resources for the GNWT in Inuvik. And I was approached by the Tribal Council a little over a year ago to come over as, you know, I am a Gwich'in beneficiary, and they wanted somebody in the role of Chief Operating Officer, so they've asked me to come on. I think that use of existing resources is the key, because we all know there isn't a lot of extra money out there. So the internship project that we have does use those secondment. So with the federal government, we're using the Canada Interchange Program. With the territorial government, we're using the secondment program. And within Tribal Council, we're using existing resources.
We would love a secondment position. How do you get one of those, I would like to know? I did ask about it, but I didn't really understand what it meant. I was like, secondment, can we? And it seemed like that wasn't an option. But that would be great. If anyone can tell me how I can get one of those, that would be amazing. But we do a lot of resource sharing with other organizations. So I didn't get into that, but we do borrow gear from other GNWT departments for our OutCamp. We do a lot of like intellectual resource sharing with a bunch of other organizations. I work closely with Dene Nowo. I'm going to ask them if I can borrow their tents for our Dachinta camp shortly. But there's a lot of resource sharing in that regard. But yes, thank you for bringing up this comment. Thank you.
Does anyone want it? Okay, well, I think it's almost coffee time. And I guess to close this panel, one of the big lessons that I've learned listening to all of our speakers, but also listening to the audience, is that in order to be successful, in order to get programs off of the ground, we have to work together and we have to share our ideas. Because if we work in isolation or if we're always starting ideas from scratch, we're going to be spinning our wheels. And I think that through collaboration that we can see a lot of success in the North. We also had a lot of great questions, languages, secondment, funding. So thank you for being an engaging audience. I think one of the hopes for this conference is that we make a lot of networks now. We introduce ourselves to each other. We make relationships, friendships. We're adding people on Facebook and Twitter. We're saying hi and bye on the street and in the airport. So we really encourage you to continue the conversations over the coffee breaks, over the health breaks. So thank you all. I hope to meet you in person. And if you could please join me in thanking our group, because it's incredibly hard to come up here and share your ideas. So thank you very much.